Well, good morning, everyone. Hope you've had a great weekend. Welcome back to another episode of Berham Engines. Right, guys, a couple of videos ago when I did the bit on, I think it was the Focus RS Mark III, and how far the crank assembly was out, etc. I noticed a good few people commented, could you basically show us how you would get these back into balance, like, for example, the clutch cover. I have done it in previous videos, but obviously if people are new and join the channel, then they're not going to have seen that. But Isaac at the moment is just balancing the crank assembly for the Cosworth engine. So that is the one here that we're waiting on the liner for. He's just about to do the clutch cover. Everything else is in balance. So we'll just head round there and see how he gets it within balance. Right, so this is the Cosworth assembly. He's balanced it. I think it's all pretty much in balance, mate. Is that right?
Yeah, so the crank, front pulley and flywheel are all balanced. Yeah. So we've just got to do that clutch cover.
Okay, so how much is this out at the minute, this clutch cover?
I think it's about 40.
Oh, it's about, yeah, so it's about 40. And going on the angle, you're looking at about zero. Usually if it's on zero or 360, it will start hovering from one to the other because obviously, but it's just slightly over that, so probably about 10. So Isaac's just going to show you how we get this back into balance.
So just stop that, take it round to the angle. You reckon it was on about 10?
Yes, yeah, so it's about 10, something like
that. Right.
So 10 on this, you know, it goes round to 36. So obviously you just take a zero off. So one on there would be 10 degrees.
Yeah. So then that, on this centre line, sort of this way,
yeah,
that's where you would, you know, that's where you actually looking for.
Okay.
So I just mark it there, you can bring it up.
So basically when you set it here on the angle, it's, you've got to remove material off this plane, that's
yeah.
right, isn't it? Or you can add material onto the other way, but obviously
yeah.
it's a lot easier to remove material if you can.
So then once you've, you know, once you've marked up and everything, you can basically just drill a hole. See if this drill is any good.
There's no set amount, is there, on this? It's
no.
just literally, you sort of get to know the machine. And
yeah.
I've said to people before, it all depends on the diameter and the material or whatever you're taking it off. So
yeah.
if you're taking it off a, if you've got 40 out, say for instance on a clutch, which is a big diameter steel, you're going to take less material off, say if a front pulley was on 40, because it's a small diameter, it's cast iron, so you'd end up drilling a bigger hole in there.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah, pretty much.
So let's drill a hole and see what difference it makes.
See if this drill's any good.
Basically, if we stuck an 8mm drill straight through the clutch cover here, and it goes down to 20, then you know roughly another 8mm hole should pretty much do it. But
yeah.
See what that takes it down to.
Look.
So yeah, that's 25-ish, 30. So going by that, I reckon another 2 8mm holes, and that should be pretty much there then.
Yeah.
Ideal. Right, mate, how we got on?
Yep, all balanced now. It's down to zero. So I'll show you that.
So there we go, the amount is zero. The angle gauge is flapping all over the shop, which means it don't know where it's out, which is a good thing.
Show the holes in the...
Yeah, show us the holes.
Got those two little divots there I had to do, and then just that little set of holes.
Ideal. So what tends to happen sometimes is, if you've got to remove quite a bit of material, it sometimes changes, doesn't it? It sort
yeah.
of moves over, so you end up drilling a couple over here, and
it's almost, if you take a little bit too much in one spot, it'll just shift round, and you know you can
right.
sort it in another area.
Yeah, so that's all balanced now. Just waiting for that liner on the cosy, but
yeah.
thank you very much, mate.
That's all right.
Right, guys, thumbnail and title time. So going back to when we bought the new head for the Centronic, if you go back to watch those videos about the Centronic and about the head there, the problems we had, the company that we sent him to who said that they could fix the unit. Now, just to recap, guys, the new valve seat cutter head for the Centronic we've got now is a non-CNC. It works absolutely brilliant. So obviously they discovered down the line that really you didn't really need it. Whether it was sort of obviously the cost of it, I would imagine now a new one of those CNC heads are going to be 15,000-20,000 quid, all of that. So yeah, just to recap, we sent the head off to a company that said, yeah, we've fixed two or three of these, no troubles whatsoever. Sent it off, we paid extra for getting it back fairly smartish, so they promised they would get it back within the week. We didn't. It went on probably about 5 weeks before we got it back. They had to have it back again because they said they couldn't fix it, this, that, the other. So yeah, you're probably best to go back and watch those videos. But where are we now? So we got a customer called Mark Harding who comes in here from Devon Tractions. Really nice bloke, Mark. And he said, well, he's got a friend who's retired, but he's an absolute genius. With electronics, he said, you know, way more superior than anyone else that he knows. So it might be worth him having a chat with this chap, this gent, and see whether he's interested to just sort of out of interest take this thing apart and see what he can find with it. So fortunately for us, obviously we said we'll pay him if he manages to fix it or whatever. Fortunately for us, he took the job on. So Mark's been in today with a little video showing us the guy, he's took the thing apart, so it shows it sort of in bits. I don't know anything about electronics, but he sort of explains it. So I've took a still from the video, and this is what he's got inside. So apparently you've got the two motors that do your X and your Y's CNC. So that's the idea of the CNC on it, is to find the center of the guide. So you get a pilot that's as good a fit as you can in the guide of the cylinder head, and the CNC just finds the exact center of it, then you lock it off, job done. So what has he found? He has found that you've got basically two circuit boards that run two motors that do your backwards and forwards, side to side, and you've got two microchips apparently that operate both, and you've got a solenoid that flips. Once one has done its centering, it flips over and does the other one, and each motor, as I say, is controlled by a circuit board in there. Now obviously these things are quite old and they don't make the circuit boards etc. anymore, so he's had it to bits, and this is what he's found in there obviously, and he said to us that the initial problem looks to be, he's almost certain that it is one of the solenoids that's the problem. He said on one of the circuit boards, one of the motors going on the X direction is still operating, but it's not going over to the other one. He said he thinks that is the problem. He's been in touch with Mira, who make the machine, and they have supplied him with a new one of those. So it looks at this point that if we'd have give it to this guy to start with, he could have rectified it for not a lot of money, to be honest with you. He said the thing is beautifully engineered, and it's very unlikely that anything's going to go wrong down the motor or the mic, or the circuit board area. But then he said the left-hand side is still not working even when he's put the new bit in. Now the circuit board, he said, has got some very fresh solder on the circuit board, so it's all been soldered back together poorly, and he seems to think that they could have done something there and buggered it up, basically fried it. So he's been in touch with Mira, no longer available, so he said unless we can get an old unit, if anyone knows one of one out there, unless we can get an old unit and use one of those circuit boards, then it looks like it's pretty toast. But what he's saying is this, it's obviously fresh solder, so it's got to have been this company that's repaired it, because we bought it from new and we've never had it repaired before. And he seems to think they could have fried it. So my feeling is at this point, not throwing any major accusations, not 100% certain, but what it's going by an expert's opinion, they fried it, they buggered it up, they've missed this little solenoid, they've gone about trying to get amongst the circuit board, buggered it up, and give it back to us with no charge. Have they caused 15,000 quid's worth of damage? Have they caused the fact that we've had to go and spend £4,500 on a new one? I'm going to have to give them a phone call and have that awkward discussion. Obviously, I don't think I'm going to get anywhere with them. They're obviously not going to admit that. But yeah, so that's where we are with it, guys. I'm going to give them a bell, see what we can come up with, and see whether we can recoup any money, because clearly it would have been a cheap fix by the looks of it. I mean, the thing has always been bulletproof, never give us any trouble before. So yeah, it's probably one of those really where they've, you know, they realised they buggered it up, just sort of kept it quiet, said they couldn't fix it, giving it us back. Did they? I don't know. But yeah, fairly annoying really. So as you can see, guys, back there on the trailer, the E30 is still here. If you want to know more about that and why it's still here, go to the second channel in tomorrow's video to find out more of what's going on there and why we've still got it. But while we're on the subject of E30s, check this out. So here we have an E30 M3 cylinder head. And when it come in here, it didn't look anything like that. So what I've done, I've put it in the vapor blaster. Now this is a car that the customer bought apparently with the engine all in the back in pieces. Compared to what the M3s fetch, I don't think he paid quite that, but he still paid quite a lot of money for it. But he wants to sort of restore the vehicle up to, you know, sort of not concourse, but he wants it looking really nice. And as you all know, or can imagine, when you open the bonnet on these, if you haven't sort of done them already, they can look fairly grotty because everything's sort of aluminium and corroded black paint and all the rest of it. So customers bought in the cylinder head. Now here we have got the carrier that carries the cams and the buckets. There are a shimmed lifter set up on these. So I've blasted all this cover top and bottom. You can see how well our vapor blaster brings all this up. Same on the head. So like I've said, what I've done, I've had to sleeve the exhaust guides. The exhaust guides were pretty sloppy. I've cut the seats on the inlet. I've got to turn it round and do the exhaust now. We've given it a very light lick over and it is faced lovely. So this thing at once upon a time has been pretty looked after. There's no corrosion or anything like that. But as you can see, it's looking absolutely lovely. Over here is the camshafts, which all look really good, and the buckets. You see it's got the top shim buckets there. So the next stage for this, guys, is I've cleaned the valves up. They're all in there and faced up. We're just going to give them a wash. I'm going to get the head on here and we're going to do the valve clearances. But yeah, really excited to see an M3 cylinder head. Well, thank you very much for watching another one of our videos, guys. Until tomorrow on the second channel, we will see you on the main channel Wednesday. Cheers, guys.